Starting? Good afternoon. Wow. Okay. Sorry, hearing my voice. Thanks for coming. I was worried that no one will show up after lunch for 3-hour tutorial. I was debating whether we should have done it at 1.5 hour. So it's nice to see you. I hope you. I won't lose you after the first part. But thanks for coming. My name is Murat Kantarcioglu. I'm a professor at University of Texas at Dallas. So if you come to CCS next year, that's where it will be, in Dallas. I work on data security, privacy, and the intersection of data mining, security, and privacy. And this is an area that we've been working on, but mainly publishing data mining topic. My collaborator, Bowei, she's a professor at Purdue University in statistics department. And we were looking into applying big data for what we call adversarial data mining. So hopefully I will try to give you some background on all these topics from different views. And these slides were kind of helped. Dr. Janzo, she's a research scientist in my group, who helped with the slides. So let me start. What's the hype? What's going on? There is a big hype in big data in US, at least. I don't know, probably in Europe as well. In terms of it's kind of seen as a magical dust to solve many problems. And of course, cybersecurity is one of those areas that's been considered. And you've seen these kind of news articles, etc., over the years. This is one example, maybe you've seen others. For example, they say that, like, this is from Gartner, they will say that the big data will revolutionize cybersecurity in the next 2 years. I don't know whether it's revolutionized. It's 2014, now it's 16. I don't know whether the revolution happened. But clearly, there is all this hype about how and how long it will take and how we can use the big data for cybersecurity. Furthermore, this hype actually kind of matched with, I would say, what's going on in the venture space. And the idea is there are many startups and VC funding for using big data analytics for cybersecurity. And there are many, many companies who are doing big data analytics for cybersecurity, including like IBM has products, HP, Splunk, and so on. And there are, I think, 100 million or more VC money is invested in startups who are doing big data analytics. So the question is, of course, what's different for cybersecurity when you have data analytics? So there's all these startups and Google doing data analytics for many, many years, let's say. So what's the new in cybersecurity, and what does the new aspects? So that will be the really the main, I would say, the motivation for this talk. So I'll try to convince you that cybersecurity is slightly different. First, of course, why this hype is happening? I guess there is lots of more data available in the recent years. Why? Because first of all, we can capture those data points. For example, we can have lots of malware samples. I think Microsoft has a challenge, like data mining challenge, on trying to understand the different malware types. And I think the Vienna has like 99.99 accuracy or something. So you have so much data gathered about, let's say, malware. Now there are so many companies selling tools that log almost every activity on either a device or on your mobile device. And there are even new tools coming into play where you can capture more and more data about your system, about the individuals on your system, what these individuals are doing, and how they are mining this data and what they are doing with this. So there are all this data coming from the different system areas. The other thing is, of course, is firewalls were there, and there are more companies who are getting some products on those, where they gather this network data, network related events, and they capture that, and they try to capture it at an even increasing, I would say, detail. So that's also bringing lots of more new data. And there are also sensors happening. I guess this is coming from the maybe IoT domain. Now you will have more devices, and those devices will be also bringing more data. And of course, you may want to use this data to figure out whether something is going wrong, whether you know, this IoT device is being hacked or captured, and so on. So the other, I would say, the changing factor is that not only big data becomes popular, but there is more data about cybersecurity. Of course, as a research challenge, it's hard to access most of these data. And I think that's a problem for researchers. So it's very hard to get real firewall logs, or if you don't do it by yourself. But still, all this data is coming. So, of course, the first question comes to mind is, at least I've talked to some over the years, some VC people as well. So what's the new about cybersecurity? For example, why can't we just get whatever your favorite data mining tool or your system, let's say, and throw the data mining tool on it and try to predict? Okay. And I think, at least this is my view, is that we have this adversary in the cybersecurity domain. And there are some other domains as well where machine learning data mining is applied, such as homeland security. But in all, most of the interesting cybersecurity related things, such as intrusion detection, fraud detection, spam, malware, etc., you have an adversary. So this really, from traditional data mining point of view, it's a big change, according to me, because here you have this active adversary who tries to avoid being detected and who tries to manipulate the data mining process. So this is a quite different than, let's say, applying data mining machine learning to detect Higgs bosons in CERN labs, because I don't think, as far as I know, I'm not a physicist, but Higgs boson tried to hide its existence, you know, from the data. But here in the cybersecurity domain, that's a big challenge. So this adaptive active adversary. So basically, new solutions really needed to address this problem from machine learning point of view, and people look into this actually. That's the part of the survey that I will summarize. I would like to bring your attention of what in the machine learning data mining community has done on this area, and then talk about some of how it could be maybe applied in practice later. The standard deviation, as I'm mentioning, a little bit more technical, is that most of the machine learning techniques have this IID, independent identical distribution assumption. So in other words, what you have seen in your test or training data, in other words, what data you collected, may look similar in the future. So it's coming from the same distribution. But of course, this is just one example, and we will see a few other attacks. But when you have more active adversaries, what you have seen may change down the road. So in this example, the adversary may have, you may see this data set, for example, and you can build a model to classify good versus bad. Let's say the red is the bad ones and the greens are the good ones. And you can build a classifier, which is the line here. It's a simple example of a machine learning model that you can learn and build. But of course, once you build this independent IID assumption may not be correct anymore, because during the test time, the attacker may change some of the features. For example, even though the data looked like distributed this way when you were building your model based on the data you have collected, but when you deploy your model, your distribution, for example, may change, and some of the points have maybe passing the classifier now. So this IID type assumptions, or the assumption of stationary process that's been heavily used in machine learning traditional tools, may not be correct anymore. So now the question is how should this handled? And this kind of, at least I used to give this example a lot and still, is that you see this in many cybersecurity domains, in spam filtering, for example. If you look at the evolution, early spam filters, for example, were used for a world Viagra, for example. Viagra was highly likely to be a spam, right? Because you don't have legitimate emails who are writing Viagra in it. But the spammers quickly learned to misspell and write Viagra in many, many different ways. So what you have seen in your data, where you have wrote Viagra, for example, for spam filter detection, suddenly was not very useful, because you are now having an adaptive attacker who is changing its behavior and writing Viagra in many, many different ways. So this is kind of this scenario. So you had seen some emails where there is some Viagra word in it, and suddenly that Viagra is misspelled. Of course, this is a simple manipulation, and people, attackers come up with many, many more. So now the question is how you could model this adaptive behavior by the attacker. And for those who know a little bit more machine learning data mining, again, I'm trying to keep the knowledge in machine learning very limited, and then there are some pointers at the end, and I will share the slides as well so you can look at those papers. But for more advanced people who has more advanced background, it's not concept drift. There is lots of work going on in machine learning data mining to understand changing concepts. So in some domains, like in social media, etc., people's tastes evolve over time. So there is lots of work on how you could evolve your machine learning models over time as the concept is changing, like what the people's taste is changing, what they like is changing. But this is not really a concept drift in this scenario, because the adversary on purpose is changing its behavior. And now, of course, there is another line of work in machine learning called online learning. And here, the idea of online learning is you want to update your model by not seeing entire data at once, but you keep seeing data coming. There are variants of it, like stream mining as well. I just captured them under one umbrella called online learning. Is that you try to learn by only seeing few instances and update your model as you see more and more data points. But again, the online learning kind of assumes that although there may be a concept drift in the online learning scenario as well, still it's not about adaptive behavior, adaptive adversary, but it's more on the side of how we can build the model as we see more data in a streaming fashion. So the biggest difference is here is that the attacker may avoid being detected by manipulating the data or its own features in two distinct time. So one is the training time. In other words, when the data that you capture to build your models could be not pure data. So this is kind of like a data poisoning attack type of thing. So in other words, you get some data where the attacker manipulated early on via different means and therefore it will impact the machine learning data analytics process. So an example would be is that if a person collecting arbitrarily let's say Twitter accounts to build social media related let's say spam filtering, some of these collected Twitter accounts by itself may be manipulated by the attacker, so that the model that you learn may not be accurate. So this is the deliberate intervention during training time. And the other thing is that I think more relevant is the test time. So the features that you use and you think it's important may be modified by the attacker. So this is an attack during the test time. An example would be you can see this in many scenarios, but the Viagra example was one where the attacker, for example, changed email content. In the case of spam filtering, the spammers have done lots of good word attacks. In other words, add lots of words to spam emails where those words are not associated with spam, so the emails look like a legitimate email. So these are the type of adaptation is coming. So I'm trying to convince you that this is really different because of this adversary. An adversary can manipulate certain phases of the data analytics pipeline to avoid being detected, like the training time or the test time. So this brings a question, and there are people try to answer this, at least somewhat theoretically and also I think practically. If this is a game between data miner and the adversary, and how we should really model this game, and especially how we should model this adversary's adaptive behavior and this training time, what I mean by is like doing our data model building or machine learning process, and the deployment time or the test time. I'll use training and test to differentiate these two. Of course, one solution idea occurs is that, and this is still relevant, you can really consistently change your model. So if you come up with a new attack, new adaptive behavior, maybe you rebuild your data mining model. And I think there were some talks I get here yesterday about how you could, for example, mine online blocks to come up new features to detect, let's say, new malware. So you can use something like that to build a new model once you have a new malware, maybe, and use it to detect. But of course, this is always a catching up type of scenario. So once you figure out something new happening, then you adapt. So the questions, at least people try to answer more on the theoretical or machine learning side, data mining side, was really how to model this adaptive behavior. I mean, can we go at least a few steps ahead? Instead of consistently changing and catching up, can we build machine learning models that are more resistant to this kind of adaptive behavior? And what does that mean? And if you think about this is a game and an arm race between the adversary who tries to avoid being detected and a machine learning data mining based model who tries to detect such a behavior, does this game ever end? So what's the end result would be? So for example, can we detect some certain attacks using this kind of automated models? Of course, at the end you can reach some undecidability stuff like many cases, but what's the end result for certain task, or can we predict it? Of course, for those who know game theory a little bit, when you talk about games, there is this equilibrium discussion. So what would be the equilibrium look like if there is one, and where the attacker and the machine learning model reach an equilibrium? So I'm going to try to, so this is the questions we try to discuss based on the existing research. And in the remainder of the talk, I'll try to first look into some foundational results and models to reason about this learning in the presence of an active adversary. There will be lots of equations, but don't be discouraged. I'll just try to give intuitions, and there will be no proofs, even though you see theorems. Those theorems are just to capture some results, so there will be no proofs or things. And I'll try to minimize machine learning knowledge, but I'll try to at least give some insights about for the people who try to do that. Then there were some, I'm going to talk about some recent techniques developed in data mining machine learning community on inspired by this foundation result and models to have more resistant classifiers, more resistant machine learning models. So I will be talking about those. It will require a little bit knowledge of SVMs. I'll try to mention it. But again, as simple as possible. And then of course, there is such a rich literature of applying machine learning already for cybersecurity problems. And I chosen some of the papers to show how some certain technique used, for example, later on attacked by the same community. So there was a paper who was saying, oh, we have a machine learning technique to detect this cyber attack. And then next year, let's say CCS, there's another paper attacking that attack, another paper attacking the attacking, and so on. So what does this mean from at least from the foundational models and why some of those attacks may not be surprising. So that's the latest part. And then I will try to conclude by some summary and suggestions, at least based on what I've seen, on how to apply them more in practical sense, like machine learning. So this will be the agenda. Please feel free to ask questions anytime if something is not clear. I hope it won't be too boring. So if it's a little bit more interactive, I guess it will be more fun. So that's the goal. So let's start with some foundational results. And in the machine learning community, this learning with noise have been, I think, explored 30, at least, many years ago. And the idea was that how we can learn if we have errors in the data. These numbers, for when I put the slides online, the numbers basically refer to the papers at the end of the slides. Here, there was lots of early development on something called pack learning model, which I won't go into detail in basically trying to understand what's learnable under polynomial time. And I think it was a Turing Award winner a couple of years ago, this pack learning model and the development of it maybe 2-3 years ago. Valiant from Harvard won the Turing Award for that work in pack learnability. So there was lots of early work in 70s, 80s about what's learnable from finite samples. So as a side note of that work, there was some work about what's learnable when you have errors in your data. And there is a precise characterization of things that are learnable. And so this early foundation results consider about this setting. The setting is that you have training data. Again, for those who are very familiar with the machine learning, we have a training data, we collect some data set. In this data set, let's say we have malware samples or a legitimate, let's say, software. And we have labels. It says, okay, this binary sequence is malware, this binary sequence is, let's say, legitimate. So you have this training data set, but in this model, the adversary may manipulate some of those points in your data set. And especially the adversary has unbounded resource. In other words, it can choose any strategy to lie. And the attacker knows, the adversary knows the target concept, the concept or the thing that the machine learning model tries to learn. That's in this terminology, they call target concept. So this the concept here is that what's the relationship between the data and the class value. Class value here, again, let's say malware or not so legitimate software. And then, and it knows everything basically in the thing. But we limit the adversary. In other words, adversary can generate with probability some parameter beta that it can generate malicious errors. So here that the attacker or adversary can look at the training data, knows everything about what you try to learn, and try to come up with the worst possible noise or worst possible modifications to the data so that it will get the best or the it will make the data mining model as, least effective as possible. So, in other words, its goal is to foil the learning algorithm. And now the question this paper long time looked into was, what can you learn under this setting? So if an adversary can arbitrarily modify, change the training data, do we have hope to learn? They look into the two different settings. So here the class C is basically what we try to learn, the concept we try to learn. And the concept, again, I mean the relationship between the data and the label, and that's something we want to learn. And then this is basically representing a given a concept. In other words, what we try to learn, this EMC represents the largest value of beta that can be tolerated by any learning algorithm for C. So this is kind of the upper bound. And here there is no basically limitations in terms of computational time. So the algorithm try to learn this concept and take as long as possible. Now the question is, if the attacker maliciously changes a subset of the data, but we have a limit, this beta is a limit, what's the best beta that we can tolerate to learn this concept? And the learning here is that I will describe a little bit more. We want to learn this accurately. In other words, you want to learn a machine learning model that can does predictions somewhat accurately. Okay. The second thing they look into is basically the more polynomial time model. So here, basically, we want to limit our learning algorithm to a polynomial time algorithm. So polynomial time, if you look at the theorems and so on, become important because if you are running polynomial time, you can only have polynomial many samples that you can go over in terms of the running time. Therefore, it puts a limitation, so you cannot want exponentially many samples, for example. So now the question is, what is the largest set of malicious error that can be tolerated by this polynomial time learning algorithm? For again, concept C. C, just to remind again, is the thing that we try to learn from the data, the concept, the relationship, let's say, between Twitter account behavior versus whether it's a spam account or a legitimate account. So that's our concept, relationship between the tweets and the spam or and so on. So the first theorem says that there is definitely an sure, go ahead. Yeah. I will come back to this in the sense their bound is they show a specific learning technique achieving this polynomial time. So when we come to that theorem, it will show. I will show a theorem something like this where I said, you know, you can learn in polynomial time with error rate this, and it will give us a lower bound. So in a sense, we will get a lower bound for this scenario. Okay. And then we will get an upper bound for the first case. So what's the upper bound on the first case? It says that there are some concept classes C where whatever the algorithm you have, you cannot expect it to have a beta that would be bigger than epsilon divided one plus epsilon. And then you may ask, what's epsilon? And epsilon here is basically, again, don't be scared, hopefully you will get the final good summary of these. But epsilon is basically in this setting used as you try to learn and you try to get a model, and they call this model epsilon good if its type 1 and type 2 errors are less than epsilon. False positive or false negatives is less than epsilon, means that this is an epsilon good hypothesis to learn this concept class C. So in this model, we have unknown concept, which is, let's say, relationship between tweets and whether a tweet is spam or legitimate. That's the concept we try to learn, but we don't know what it is exactly. Our algorithm learns something, and that's a hypothesis. And if that hypothesis is good, epsilon good, then it means that it's false positive and false negative both are less than epsilon. Okay. So this says that there are some certain classes, and whatever you do, okay, those classes there is no algorithm that can handle beta bigger than epsilon divided by 1 plus epsilon. So in other words, if you want to achieve error rate at most epsilon, beta must be less than epsilon divided by epsilon. How the proof works, again, I'm not doing any proof, but they kind of construct a specific class. And for that class, they show that information theoretically, etc., there is no such learning algorithm. And that will was an upper bound. Of course, what does upper bound means from practice is that if the attacker can do an arbitrary change in the data that you are using to build a model, then there is some limit, there should be some limit to attacker capabilities, because otherwise you shouldn't be expecting to learn a very good model. So in a sense, like if garbage is in, you will have those garbage out type of thing. But if the garbage is small enough, then you could learn a good model. And this result, interestingly, is for holds even for algorithms with unbounded computation resources, and it holds regardless of the time. In other words, like running more will not help, or having more sample will not help. So this is kind of upper bound on the malicious error rate. The second thing is that they come up with kind of a lower bound, and again, this is the development is quite involved. They use chain of bounds, this and that. But let me try to at least give you the intuition of this lower bound. Again, let's assume that you have a concept class. In other words, like you have a problem where you have an algorithm A that can come up with a data mining model with a good accuracy. Again, remember the epsilon. But let's assume that model uses certain number of samples. In other words, in order to learn that, we need to have enough data points in our data set. And we assume that that number depends on, let's say, epsilon, which is how good the result we want it to be. And it depends on this delta. And delta means in pack learning, and that's, again, Turing Award-winning formalization, it says that the algorithm A running after seeing approximately this many samples will output a good model with probability 1 minus delta. In other words, we assume that without any attacker involvement, we have a learning technique after seeing certain number of samples will output a good model with high probability. If you have such an learning algorithm, what this result showed that, then assume, let's look at how many samples this algorithm needed for much less error, okay? And we are okay that half of the time we will be failing. So if our algorithm can run, but half of the time it may fail. If we get this S, okay, and whatever the number of S is, then the beta that we can do, remember the beta tolerance stuff, in other words, the malicious attacker can change the beta, with probability beta, the values in the training data set, that then we can withstand a beta something like this. So it's relationship between the epsilon that we need in the modified algorithm and also the sample size. So this is a lower bound because they show that if you have a good method, okay, you will need more samples probably, and the better that you can withstand, in other words, the attacker's manipulation that you can stand, will be bounded by the lower error rate and this one. So this kind of shows that roughly, if you have more and more data based on this, you can still learn good results from the data. To summarize, again, I know a little bit math in it, but to summarize, this error tolerance against data poisoning did not come at the expense of efficiency or simplicity, but you may need more data points. You may need more larger data set. And the attacker capabilities are bounded based on the complexity. So what's inherent here is that this S is kind of related to how complex the concept you try to learn. Therefore, it has some relationship between the complexity of the concept you try to learn or the complexity of the model that you try to build. I skipped the proofs, etc., but they were showing that in these results you can tolerate higher error rates when you have both types of examples. In other words, like you have examples of a legitimate, let's say, Twitter account and a malicious Twitter account. So if you have samples from both cases, this shows that you can withstand even higher error rates. So having both type of examples, good and bad, legitimate and spam, or let's say malware versus legitimate software, makes it easier to withstand against this kind of poisoning attacks. And this has, I think, at least theoretically, has interesting relationship between the learning with malicious errors and this data poisoning attacks. So therefore, in summary, you could really learn, even if there's a data poisoning attack, as long as based on what you are learning, the poisoned instances are small. And I chose a paper when we do the, hopefully if you are still around, when we do the more application part, we choose an example where they do data poisoning attacks, and then you can see, for example, the accuracy doesn't fall too much if the poisoned samples is small, but then if it becomes something big, then you see there's falling down. So we see an example of this theoretical result in action when we cover another paper. This was very early work, and then it was more on the learning and theoretical issues when we are learning from the data and the attacker poisoning the data that we are trying to learn and build models. The other set of foundational work look into what happens is if the data is manipulated during the deployment or test time. Like in the spam detection example I was giving, right? You change the email contents, you basically add good words into your email or write Viagra in a different way. So when doing deployment, what happens if the instances are modified? And also, of course, intrusion detection, there are many examples of it. You can change, for example, packet lengths, etc. There are some intrusion detection models out there looking to network intrusion detections, the packet length, this and that. There, attacker may randomize it, may modify it. In the case of malware detection, of course, there is polymorphic malware that changes the binary. So extracting signatures is changing and becoming tougher. Fraud detection, there is lots of adaptation happened by the fraudsters and so on. So now we are talking about a scenario where attacker tries to adapt in the test time. Most of the models that we'll be considering will be looking this from a game theory point of view. I don't want to turn this into a game theory class, so I won't be going into any equilibrium discussions and so on. But for those who know game theory, we will be doing basic Nash equilibrium type scenario and leader-follower Sekalberg games. So what does this game and game theory looks like is, again, a little bit equations, but I'll try to explain the basics of that. So you have a training set and a test set in this setting. So you have given a scenario where you want to learn a data mining model from this training set. Okay? And here you try to have this classifier C, and given X, it will try to predict the class value. So for example, this classifier could be like S could be the set of spam legitimate emails, and we have some certain email set we want to test our models on. So we learn a classifier from S that will give an email, try to predict whether it's a spam or not. So now here we are now bringing utility and adaptation of the attacker into the play. In other words, how the attacker or the defender can measure the different features. So here we are assuming that each instance is a set of features. For example, whether a certain word exists or whether the email is coming from a certain server, for example. These are all could be features. And you assume some kind of cost. And then most of the models and the others have some kind of utility. In other words, what's the utility of classifying an instance as YC when it's actually Y? So in this example, let's say positive and negative, you have two class only. And of course, you would assume that if something is negative, and then you classify it as positive, you would lose some money because you make a mistake. And similarly, when something positive is negative, you would the data mining point of view, you are doing a classification error. In other words, you are misclassifying a legitimate email, let's say a spam, and vice versa. Of course, if you are correct, your assumption is that they are basically your utility is positive. So now we are kind of trying to, this is one of the early work, I think 2004 or something, try to now actively model this adaptation and this game between the data mining, machine learning model builder and the adversary. Of course, in order to do this game, you need to talk about utilities, and that's why this discussion comes into play. I think most important part of this is to modeling attackers' adaptive behavior. So this is, I think, maybe quite challenging from real point of view, but at least all these foundational results says that if you want to be at least a couple of steps ahead in the game, you need to understand how attacker can potentially manipulate the data. And for that reason, most of the models have something of this form, and we will see a couple of such model examples, is that you have an instance X, positive means it's in this case controlled by the attacker, positive means it's a spam basically in this scenario, or a malware, or, you know, intrusion, for example. And then the attacker may modify the instances under their control from something like X to X prime, okay? And that's the attacker's potential modification. And now the important thing is that what's the cost of changing the IT feature? For example, we will see some examples later on. Your model could be classifying network packets as intrusions or not. And one of your features could be the packet length, okay, average packet length for the connection. So now the question this theoretical model says is, from attacker point of view, how easy or costly for attacker to modify that feature that you are using? So that's the crucial thing used in this stuff. So this kind of captures this change by the attacker. So in a sense, you have this modeling scenario for the attacker. So you need to understand your attacker in a sense. Of course, the attacker will win if, let's say, spam emails are classified as legitimate emails. So the attacker will get utility when the classifier classifies something wrong, let's say. Therefore, attacker wants it to be classified wrong, you know, if it's positive and it's classified as negative. So in other words, if it's spam and if it's classified as legitimate, then the attacker will win. But if it's spam and the classifier gets it, attacker doesn't get money. Here, attacker doesn't care about the other scenarios. So attacker is worried about the fact that it's the things under its control is passing this data mining model and it's classified as legitimate, etc. And that's what this part tries to capture. This early work from University of Washington many years ago tried to model this as a one move by each player. Okay, so you start with a data mining model, attacker learns it and so on, and they try to understand how this evolving happened. The big assumption in almost all of these foundational results is that you both sides know everything. So from game theoretic point of view, for those who know game theory, this is like a complete information game in a sense. Each side knows whatever happens. And the early work looking to this very simple classifier called naive Bayes models. So here you estimate the probability distribution using this naive approximation, and you classify something as positive if the probability that given X, the probability that it's positive divided by given X probability that it's negative is bigger than this threshold based on the utility. And these probabilities are learned using basic naive Bayes assumption. That's for those who have taken any machine learning classes, like the first thing I guess everybody's teaching. But from our point of view, it's not as important. But basically, we have from data, we learn some model that gives given X the probability that it's positive or not. And that's using many different models. So adversaries. So in this scenario, like the question becomes, what's the adversary's optimal strategy? Again, as I want to emphasize that it has complete information, and while developing adversary's optimal strategy, they assume that classifier is unaware of its presence, and the adversary tried to modify features such that, and that's the important part, the transformation cost is less than the expected utility. In other words, attacker can arbitrarily change what's the data we observed as long as it's profitable for the attacker. So in other words, what we have seen in the past will not be really has any relationship to the future because attacker can modify it arbitrarily. But there is a limit. The limit is that attacker is rational and it will modify these instances based on this. If you recall, we assume that there is a kind of weight there. This becomes solving an integer linear program, which is quite tough to do it for finding optimal solution. And in other words, like given a classifier, what's the optimal modification? You need to solve a very complex optimization. And similarly, if you look at the classifier, you need to come up with an adversarial scenario. Here, the assumption is that adversary uses an optimal strategy for a given classifier, and therefore, the initial training data is actually not tempered in this scenario, and this transformation cost is a semi-metric. Now, what the classifier is doing is this. Basically, it given X, it predicts as YC, but the important thing is that here, instead of using traditional probability, it uses a different probability distribution. And this probability distribution becomes something like this, given something, assume that something is spam, let's say, what is the probability that I see a X prime? And this will depend on what was the probability that I would see X, some certain X against the domain, and that X is converted to X prime. So in other words, when you try to measure the probability of something, you need to figure out the fact that this may not be really X prime, it may be X originally, but it may be turned to X prime. So that's this probability happening. And this involves, again, solving some integer linear programming things combined with some other linear program stuff. I think if you combine optimally, it will become NP-hard somewhere. So it's quite complex, but I think the, from more practical point of view, what this foundation says that you should start, in order to be one step ahead, you should start modeling the attacker capabilities. After that work, there were different type of game theoretical models applied to this scenario. This is one model. Here it is slightly different in the setting. Here you have an adversary, and the adversary chooses an action, let's say whatever that action is, modifying the data. And the data miner observes this action and chooses another classifier based on it. And the game ends with this. So this is a very basic model, but this model, so it's not very realistic maybe, but it has interesting implications for choosing features for data mining, and which in adversarial data mining. So it looks a little bit unrealistic, but it, bear with me, it will have some it would have some kind of real impact results, at least intuitions, after all this math. Here it's assumed that this is a, this is called standard mixture models. So you have good class, bad class. Again, most of this foundation work assume you have two things, like legitimate mails, spam, malware versus regular software, intrusion, non-intrusion. So it's usually have two classes. So this is a basically a mixture model. In other words, you assume that data that you are seeing is a vector. Again, these are features that you are using in your model. It could be, again, like the packet length, you know, for example, or some packet frequencies. Let's say you do n-gram models. Or it could be in malware, like the function calls and, you know, certain API calls. And then you can use the API calls as features, etc. So these are arbitrary features. Now, here, the assumption is, again, the attacker can modify the bad class. So this is, these are basically probability density functions. And the attacker can arbitrarily change the distributions. Once you write this, you can start writing optimal solutions to this. Again, I know it's getting boring around 3 p.m., but just to summarize, what will happen is that if you can start writing those equations, you can start saying that given attacker strategy space, I will define what is this, you can always find the best classifier. And this classifier will be will have this error basically. Okay, so the classifier will be defined given the attacker's options and distributions, and then you can define the utility. Here, this utility involves again cost of classifying some instance. Let's say legitimate as illegitimate, or spam as legitimate, and so on. Okay, and the data miner, of course, given the attacker's thing, tries to minimize the minimize its cost. Now, the big assumptions again here in this model is changing a feature or modeling instance has a cost to adversary. This is, again, very crucial things in all these adversarial data mining models, is that there must be a cost to adversary in adaptive behavior. If there is no cost, these theoretical models show that attacker can always defeat any machine learning technique. And if there is no cost, basically, to change the instances, it can always find a legitimate class and copy it. For example, if you just do the content, if you do like say tweet-based spam analysis, and if your classifier looks only in the content of the Twitter account, as an attacker, I can always choose a legitimate Twitter account, let's say President Obama, and I can copy everything on that, right? Of course, you need to have additional features that I cannot copy, like, for example, IP addresses. You know, if it's not coming from Washington, D.C. versus Russia, you may know that one account is not legitimate. So in other words, this says that if the features that you are measuring for your model can be arbitrarily manipulatable by the attacker without any cost to attacker, then you have no hope. Okay, it's very trivial in a sense, but that's the reason it's very important to understand which features has cost and so on. Okay, and then once you do it, you can write the attacker's utility. Once you write the attacker's utility, this becomes a something called a Sekelberg game. And this is also called leader-follower games. And Sekelberg games have interesting, actually, applications in homeland security. Milan Tambe and his colleagues, I think he was at USC, his colleagues applied this to this kind of games for airport security, like how to optimize for random checks at the airport. They have lots of models that use this game theoretical Sekelberg game. So it's really a workhorse for many different areas. So you can, this was one of the early work that applied this to this problem, and you can solve for equilibrium, and you can figure out what will happen given attacker's transformation of the instances, your response, and how you could choose the best classifier. Needless to say that this is very complex and you cannot solve it for arbitrary scenarios. If you know the distributions, you can solve for it. This paper has actually, I'm co-author of this one, has like 8 pages of equations in one derivation. So, which I didn't do it, Bowei did it, so that, don't ask me if you read that. But basically, what's the intuition behind all this? I will skip this. What is that? This kind of bring like how to choose attributes for adversarial learning, okay? And the intuition for this word was, okay, go with the most predictive attribute, right? This is the traditional, what you do in data mining. Like you use information gain and other measures to choose the most predictive attribute. But as the attacker adapt, most predictive attribute may not be the good one. And of course, you can remember, I keep mentioning, like it must be hard for attacker to change the feature that you are using. Otherwise, attacker can arbitrarily modify it. So you can say, oh, well, choose the hardest feature to change. So this model kind of indicate that really you need a different way of thinking. And here, I'll just give a very basic example of what this all this theory tried to imply was, assume you have 3 features or attributes, let's call them x1, x2, and x3. And you want to choose one feature for building a model. This means that this feature distributes like normal with mean 1 and standard deviation 1, and the for good class and bad class it has mean 4 and variance 1. So this means 1 and 3.5. For those who can imagine distributions, this, if you look at this feature, these 2 classes, good and bad, are most separate because their means are different, okay? So by looking at which feature is very predictive without any adversarial thinking, okay, this would be the best feature because this is the best separating these 2 classes, good and bad, okay? If you look at from attacker point of view, what is the hardest to modify? What is the hardest to change? And, basically, change by the attacker, you would see that the first one is more better because it has higher penalty for attacker. But when you start looking at the adaptation, you realize that really you need to have, this is the very equilibrium behavior coming to play. This has the lowest error actually. So you have this, the second feature is not as predictive as the third one, or it's not as hard for attacker to change like the first one, but it's really a good combination of both. So therefore, these models, of course, do you need, 30 pages to write, come up with this conclusion, but it says that you really need to combine a predictive features that are also hard to change, and you need to really balance these two. In the previous game, the leader was the leader, and the leader was the attacker. So there was some criticism of that, saying that why we are being reactive, why don't we become proactive in terms of building our models? So there was some work, this is by Bergner et al., on changing it. Here, the data miner is the leader, or machine learning builder is the leader, and the attacker is the follower. And they try to solve the Stackelberg game in this scenario. So in other words, how we could do the Stackelberg game in this setting. Again, I'll skip, I think, as more people are leaving, I'll start skipping more equations, I guess. That's a cue for me to go over all those equations. If no one's left, that's fine too. But anyway, so they tried to come up with a slightly different modeling in terms of utilities. Just basically, at least to give the intuition, is that now, again, here, you know, leader, learner, and an adversary, and it has some utility functions. Again, this is in the foundation results, you have always this utility functions happening, like, and there the game theory come into play. Important thing in this one is that they do something like SVM, support vector machine type of scenario, and the cost has, from the data mining point of view, has this W, which is the linear boundary that you try to learn, and there is some kind of regularization factor here to punishing the learner to have a complex model, and that's this part. From the attacker point of view, attacker can do arbitrary change to the data set, that's the dot, and it has also cost associated with D and D dot. So in other words, moving D to D dot, what's the cost? Again, as you see, almost all the models have some sort of penalty for modification. Now you have another game. Now the leader decides the W. In other words, leader says what's the W that we are learning, which is the linear vector. So here the classifier will be WX bigger than some threshold, based on that you will classify. An adversary now observes this and changes the data distribution based on this observed scenario under the utility function. So unlike the previous model, in this model, the data miner starts first, publishes the data mining model. Now the attacker tries to adapt to this model by changing the data that it will be classified. So the adversary basically tries to minimize its optimization. In other words, given the data mining model, again, this is basically a hyperplane, what's the minimum cost modification for me based on my utility function? Of course, from the leader point of view, to find the optimal W, you need to think one step ahead, right? Because if basically, I'll just skip it, but basically you need to solve an optimization problem where you say that, okay, I want to choose W that minimax this utility I have for W, but I know that if I choose W, the attacker will try to find the minimum cost modification to its data. So I need to solve this two-level optimization to find the best W. Again, here you get a Stackelberg game and you can do Stackelberg equation. An interesting thing here is that, at least for when you have game theory, unless the adversary's cost is changed, or in other words, like if it's becoming cheaper or easier for attacker to manipulate that feature, or unless the learner's cost changes, in other words, building data mining model somehow gets cheaper and so on, this shows that this will be the best you can do for this learning problem. So this equilibrium behavior kind of predicts the future. What I've skipped is that it's basically you try to learn these costs, and then they do some experiments to show what this model can learn, but again, it's a linear classifier. So there were other foundational work as well, but I just chose a three different flavor of, or four, I would say, flavor, like foundational results in terms of poisoning the data from the data that you are learning and the data that you are seeing during classification and what are the implications. Later work, these are all appeared in machine learning data mining venues, all these papers. Later work tried to get these, I would say, foundational results and try to make it, change it, these insights from foundation results, and try to modify the existing machine learning techniques with those insights. So what's the main insight, I would say, is that you need to start modeling attacker capabilities, and you need to start modeling the attacker so that you could be more resistant to potential attacker manipulation down the road, okay? So again, coming to our early example is how, this is one of the work, so how can we, for example, have a support vector machine, which is a workhorse of machine learning models. And what support vector machine learning tries to do is that you have a set of data points, okay, and you try to find a hyperplane, this is in two dimension, that separate, that has this highest margin. In other words, you find this plane that has the highest separation margin, okay? So that's support vector, and in order to do that, you need to solve an optimization problem, and there are many SVM models that you can use. So now the one of the work in applying this foundation results to coming with new machine learning models, use support vector machines, because you can modify its optimization with the attacker capabilities in mind. Again, now you know attacker capabilities, now you want to maybe modify this results. So how does it work? Again, there are some equations, but I'll try to just give the intuition. In this work, they think what the attacker can do and try to put it into the optimization of SVM is solving. So there are two types of attacks that attacker may be doing for the test time. One is assuming that the attacker can change the features delta I delta j based on some parameters. Here, this small cf and the capital cf determines how much an attacker can modify any given feature. Again, you start seeing that in the data mining model, you try to model attacker capabilities. In the other, they call it targeted attack. Actually, we call it targeted. I was a co-author of this one. Targeted attack, where you know a good sample. In other words, you have a target, let's say, tweet account, and you try to get closer to it, but you have some limitations, you know, how much you can change your instance to get closer to your target. And that's, again, some math things there, not so important. So what you do is that once you have this kind of adversarial modeling, you modify a traditional, let's say, SVM. Traditional SVM part will be usually composed of something like this part is different though, but this is the, where the traditional SVM will happen. So I mean, forget about all starting from here. This part, assume it's not there. This would be the traditional SVM. Traditional support vector machine. What the traditional support machine is, so basically I'm saying, I don't know if it's clear, I should have put it there maybe. Forget the bottom part here and just focus on the top part. That's the traditional SVM is trying to solve. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so I have a question.
Sure.
It's like most of these regards are focusing on misclassifying the malicious data as benign.
Yeah. If it's just one, you know, like, then you can just change the class. It doesn't change. But if it's both at the same time, I don't think most things model that, but it can be modified to model, I think. So in some cases, it will be a trivial extension, but in some models, I don't think it will be trivial because it's quite complex to solve the equations. So usually that the assumption is that you have a malicious, you know, like you want to make your spam email to be classified as mail. The second thing is that why most papers don't assume that is they assume that the attacker doesn't control the legitimate emails. For example, the legitimate email that I'm sending to is not controlled by the attacker. I write that email, so he doesn't control it. He only controls the spam space. Of course, if he chooses to write a real email, you know, I don't know what that means, but yeah, I don't think not that many papers look into that.
See, what's happening is now people are getting all these legitimate email data sets from the internet.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So the attacker can poison those by inserting the spam words into the legitimate email.
That's in the poisoning scenario. This is for in the testing case, not the model learning case, but more in the testing scenario. But that's, I think, an interesting point to look into. All I was trying to say here in the slide is that this is a very similar to standard SVM. So if you are doing like an SVM, as I mentioned, you would be solving this optimization without these bottom parts. So basically what you are trying to find a separating thing that has this C value here, which is basically trying to do this, minimize this function here. And C tries to, is added here for the slack variables. And the slack variables is that sometimes you cannot separate nicely like this. And here the traditional SVM tries to, tries to give a room for that, and this is the traditional SVM is solving. Now, once you have this attacker things, in other words, once you know that attacker can modify the features that you've seen in the data during test time, you add more constraints here, automatically modeling the attacker's behavior, okay? So you could do such equations for the targeted scenario. Again, you can change the SVM. So what does this try to do really? Okay, let me try to at least capture from a small, simple example. Is that this is a very basic scenario. Here you have just a hypothetical case where you have two features in your model, and then these are basically positive examples, the pluses, and the negative ones are green ones. And if you do a traditional data mining, positive ones are the bad class. The traditional SVM will choose this as the boundary, okay? Because it separates these two classes, okay? But this but attacker can potentially manipulate what you have seen, right? So that's would be the attacker manipulation during deployment. What this blue line, which is this adversarial SVM, tries to do is tries to basically in advance give some kind of slack for the adversarial behavior, but not too much. In other words, if you try to move past this blue line too far away, then you are making lots of errors on the other side. Maybe you will always figure out a spam email correctly, but you will be classifying many legitimate emails as spam. So this optimization, the complex optimization, try to really balance between the attacker's potential modification and movement through the boundary, but not too much. And where this comes into play, it comes into play all in these parameters. In other words, we are assuming that for each feature, we know how much attacker can modify. Based on that, we try then this optimization problem solving here, tries to find a boundary that balances between having errors where you classify negative instances more positive between the attacker's manipulation. So, and I don't have results here, but you can show that. Yeah, go ahead.
So this is kind of a trade-off. I'm accepting more false negatives so that I don't have many more positives.
Yeah. So now the question is, how does that boundary could be done? It becomes on attacker capabilities. So if the attacker is very, very powerful and can change anything arbitrarily, of course, you have no hope, as we mentioned. Now, if it's very strong or powerful, then you may want to be more conservative on this side. And again, it depends on this balance that you try to solve here. So what does this model says is basically you try to have an optimization model to build your data mining where constraints are tied to adversarial attack models. You don't exactly know what the attack here. I just want to emphasize that. You need to somewhat estimate the attacker's capabilities in changing the features. So you don't know what exactly the attacker may change or adapt, but you know, you model its behavior, okay? And you can show that, of course, once you build a model, empirically at least, show that this is more resistant than other SVM models. And for those, it will be a little bit technical, but for those who know one-class SVM, this is better than one-class SVM that just uses, let's say, the good data points or the negative instances as well. So this using the attack points help also. So this was here in this scenario. We assumed that attack. We always observe the features, but the attacker can basically manipulate those features. So in this SVM model, the attacker was manipulating features by adding this delta ij. It could be positive, negative, but it was manipulating the features. Now, there were other work that look into what happens if there is a missing or corrupted feature. So in other words, attacker, because of attacker manipulation, not all the features are available at test time to differentiate good versus bad. Again, like in most scenarios, initially it has instances drawn from IID. This is, you know, class value and this is X. Again, this is linear margin-based classifiers thing of SVM. And then again, here the assumption is that you have clean, uncorrupted training data to learn initial classifier. Remember, as I mentioned, classifier is basically a WX is bigger than or equal to B. So it's a linear classifier. So basically you have this training data, and the training data have all the features. And for all the features, you learn this classifier, which are W1 to whether the N or N, and you have this B value where you're thresholding. And the test data has now at each time have missing, potential missing features. And now attacker can hide certain features when you are trying to do classification. So now this is a slightly different model. Again, we are trying to model the attacker capability directly in our machine learning thing. And here the attacker tries to basically do this type of choosing which subsets. Again, this becomes the standard results apply here. If the adversary is all powerful, you can of course delete all the features in during test time, and it will be useless. Okay, and again, there is an assumption that each feature has some certain values. Again, you see in this work as well some kind of modeling of attacker capabilities and certain valuations. And here, for example, and limitation of the attacker. Here, the limitation is that adversary must leave a certain subset which has certain value you intact. In other words, it has to basically. Oops. Okay. Uh-oh. Sorry. It has to leave some certain subset of features intact, but it can choose which features to delete before the testing. So again, as more people are leaving, I'm skipping more equations. Yes. I'm sorry, isn't that feature? Correct, that's the reason theoretically the attacker can randomize. That's the reason we have done something like this. So here theoretically it can choose 1, 2, 3, 5, then the next one can choose 3, 4, so it can randomize in this model. So again, in order to skip more equations, basically what they've shown is that you can write this as a optimization problem, and you can have an algorithm that solves this optimization problem to come up with a learning method that's resistant to those kind of attacks. Again, the intuition is model the attacker capabilities. Don't know exactly the attack, but the capabilities, and learn a classifier that is being resistant to that capability. Again, we don't know the attack, but just the capability. There were a few other things done on this work, especially inspired by spam filtering. Again, this is all machine learning. In the second half, I would be having more CCS type of papers, so that will be covered. So don't leave for the second half. So you done the most boring half, okay? So I promise the second half is more fun. So there were, as I mentioned, like good word attacks where you have things. And this work tries to look at a slightly different model. Here, I will again skip this, but they try to do this reverse engineering scenario. In other words, you have a remember the previous scenario, right? The previous scenario, the attacker always tried to change the instances so that it will pass the classifier. This work tried to figure out how hard it is for an attacker, if there is a black box classifier, to figure out. In the previous work, always the attacker knows the entire classifiers, entire machine learning models. Here in this setting, the attacker doesn't know the classifier you are using. It's hidden. And it's trying to figure out an instance that will pass the classifier. In other words, it tries to figure out a spam email that will pass the spam filter. It doesn't know the spam filter rules, it doesn't know the weights, unlike the previous work. Now it tries to change the email, for example, by adding good words, such as, you know, good words from legit emails, or most frequent English words, let's say, so that it can pass the thing. And this accurate learning, they call it adversarial classifier reverse engineering, they try to really find an instance, again, there is this cost function A here, that will be, that's actually a bad instance, or let's say spam, that will be classified as basically non-spam. And the assumption here is that you have one positive and one negative instances classified by this classifier, and the attacker now can probe this classifier, can probe this machine learning model, okay? So it can run queries, and then it can figure out whether the this is classified as spam or legitimate, etc. By this. Interesting result this shows is that, of course, linear models are quite easily reverse engineerable. Basically, they call it 1 plus epsilon learnable. In other words, you can, here the k comes into fact that you don't always want to minimize. You are okay if it is less than the k times the minimal cost. So if you have linear models for as a classifier like SVM and so on, for attacker point of view, it needs to just do polynomial time queries, and it can find an instance that will pass the classifier quite accurately. So that's this work saying that also you can easily reverse engineer the classifier even if you don't know it, under certain scenarios. In some cases, they prove that, again, I don't have it here, they prove that it's MP hard to do such reverse engineering attacks. I will not start, maybe I would stop here for this part and answer any questions. Okay, I don't want to go to other one, maybe after more coffee. I will continue. Are there any questions? To summarize this half is basically there are so many modeling techniques, and they are around on modeling adversarial capabilities and bringing a little bit game theory. Is there any question? Yeah. Sure, go ahead, please. Thanks.
Making more harder attacks to have more features. So if you have a limited amount of features, the cost of changing one of those features could be hard.
Of that's so. I think the question is that so why don't we add more and more features?
Yeah.
So it will be harder for attackers to adapt.
Yeah.
The issue comes is that if you have they call it curse of dimensionality in machine learning literature. So if you have a higher dimensional feature space, then learning requires more and more samples. So therefore, there is, from forget about adversarial scenario, there is all this feature selection done in traditional machine learning data mining, because when you have high dimensional feature space, you have this curse of dimensionality. Therefore, you try to use dimensions. So in many machine learning first thing you do is to do like some kind of feature selection, then dimension reduction, so that you cannot have arbitrarily many dimensions. Does that answer your question?
Solutions, yeah, the approaches to the curse dimensionality. Can't you use those approaches to attack the problem of adversarial learning?
Maybe, I don't think there is, I'm not aware of any work that tries to combine dimension reduction, curse of dimensional type of things with adversarial learning. I'm not aware of that. Yeah, please.
I think there was a question ahead of me before I came up to the mic. You had your hand up. Okay. So I'm working somewhat in this space for my dissertation, and one of the things I'm surprised I didn't hear you talk about was the scarcity problem when it comes to attacks, which is something that we've struggled greatly with. The idea that ultimately the feature set you're exploring to try to do prediction of attacks is going to be very, very, very imbalanced. So when we've tried to apply this to some real problems, that's one of the biggest issues we've run into, so could you
mean
talk
that,
about that?
So that problem, I think you're referring to class imbalance problem?
Yes.
That problem itself has been addressed in other machine learning domains. That's the reason I try to focus on what's new in the adversarial setting. In other words, the problem that you have few samples in one class, happens, for example, in HIV prediction as well. So you have many, many more people who are non-HIV versus HIV in your data set.
Yes.
And there's lots of research done. Like you can give an entire tutorial on how to deal with class imbalance problem. So there, of course, this area is rich. I mean, even 3 hour is too short, I guess, but luckily it's 3 hour, okay, don't be afraid. I didn't choose that area, but that's okay. That's been an issue irrespective of adversarial setting. It's like a problem in other domains in machine learning as well.
Sure, we can talk about it more often.
Yeah, sure, of course, I would love to. Any other question before we go to break? Okay, yeah, go. Yeah, I will make everything available online after today. And with the citations are there, at least we sampled 15 papers or so. Thanks. Hopefully you'll come back after break. I will be here at least. Left, I will quickly mention from the more theoretical foundational part. There was some recent work. Usually when I give such a talk, they say, oh, you only look into one type of adversary, one game. What happens if you have multiple adversaries with different capabilities? How will you do that? So there was some recent work in the data mining community, actually this is our work, to look into multiple type of adversaries. I'll skip that to focus on the more applied part, but there are some game theoretical learning frameworks where you assume the leader, the data mining model, needs to deal with different type of adversaries, which I couldn't do. So instead of having traditional things we look into, like in the previous part, where there's a one leader, one follower, one bad adversary with certain capabilities, what happens if your learning model needs to deal with different type of adversaries with different capabilities? So there are some work, including ours, on trying to do this. And it involves building models for different type of adversaries and then combine them with some kind of mixed strategy method. Again, since I promised no more equations and theoretical part, I skipped that, but there is some work into understanding multiple type of adversaries as well. So finally, the application part. There are many papers to try to apply machine learning, data mining for cybersecurity intrusion detection problems. In the remaining part, I try to choose the ones that are being attacked or how attacks could have happened to illustrate why you really need to think about the next step and the foundations. So one of the early examples of using machine learning data mining was for malicious PDF detection. And the reason I chose that one was because this work is being attacked as well. Like there are some attacks who are trying to defeat this data mining model. So I think this kind of shows you this, remember the game models we discussed, you know, like their leader does something, follower does something in the machine learning set. So what was this early model? The early model was something like this. There is this a PDF document and, you know, PDF, I didn't know, but I learned baseball when I read this paper. It turns out that PDF is kind of tree structure document, and you have some kind of root node, let's call it, I think it's like slash catalog, and it has some other valid elements in the body of the PDF. And you can have something like a header, you know, some body, some cross-reference tables, some trailer part, etc. So there is apparently such PDF documents. And it turns out that PDF documents can contain malware in it. And this malicious PDFs may have malware payload or small size code where they exploit some vulnerability to download more code. And some of these machine learning techniques, data mining techniques, have been applied to this PDF malware domain to detect PDF malware. How these techniques work? they look into many features such as whether it has JavaScript in it, it has embedded something, malformed object, some certain malicious patterns. Also, even if everything is encrypted apparently in PDF, encryption is done, if you think about the tree, only certain nodes of the tree. Therefore, you can still look into the encrypted part and still learn something. So what this work was doing is that they do this statistic analysis on the features from the document structure and metadata, and they claim that in this work they claim that this works quite well. Even some parts is encrypted because of you can still get the structure and interesting metadata information, especially from normal documents. And then what they do is that they build classifiers. The classifiers are random forests and other work. And they have actually dual-level classifier. One level gives a PDF input, and then it says it tries to differentiate benign versus malicious. And in malicious, they do two different malicious types. The one called it opportunistic, and the other one's target. So they divide the PDF malware based on the capabilities. It's not as important what the details are, but they have this two-level classifier. And when they look at this classifier, they throw in basic techniques such as naive Bayes model I mentioned, the support vector machines you saw it, at least even the optimization in the last part. And then they have also random forest. By the way, random forest is such a workhorse in anything. The first machine learning technique I think you should throw in is random forest. You know, try with random forest, and then that will be your baseline. And then try improving on it. And almost in many cases I've seen random forests do quite well. Of course, deep learning, etc., beats it in other settings. But you know, it's a good initial baseline everybody throws in. And here, actually, it turns out to be the best model. It has very little error. And they can train this malware detection software in like 92 seconds, you know, and classification is less than a second, basically. And then this is their classifying target. Remember, some people were asking about, class imbalance. I don't know where is he? Maybe he left. Oh, you're here still. Here, for example, if you think about it, although some targeted malware part is little, but 5,000 benign, 5,000 basically malware. So it's a very balanced, for example, in this setting. And then they have 100,000 testing testing operational ones. So this is an example showing that, look, machine learning techniques can come up with a super duper classifiers where we can very accurately, the error rate is like 0.99 something, can detect. So now again, remember all this foundation results say that like think one step ahead. So how the attacker can change, how the attacker can modify. So the follow-up, before coming to that, so this is their accuracy results, false positive, false negative. Basically here they're showing that if you do like only false positive rate of 0.02, you can get closer to 0.99 accuracy. So it turns out that malicious versus benign is very, very accurate. You can distinguish them very quickly for distinguishing between opportunistic versus targeted. If you recall, it has two layers, distinguishing benign versus malicious, and malicious, they try to distinguish this two-type malicious. It's not as good, but still they have not good accuracy here as well. Above, it's not like 999 something, but it's above 90% and so on accuracy. So again, this is kind of showing that, look, machine learning techniques can work very well, and a human cannot look every PDF document, but in a second, we can come up with a good, you know, accurate result about whether this PDF document is malware or not. So, of course, again, not thinking next step, how the attacker may adapt, have a paper out of it. So basically, in this work, they look at the previous one and try to figure out how you can attack this machine learning model. Of course, as we know, the attacking will happen based on changing features. Now the question is, in PDF domain, which features you can change? So they really investigate this previous work and the random forest one. Why? Because it's the best one, right? It has accuracy of, well, what does it, like 90.99 accuracy. And here the attacker now modifies the PDF file. In a sense, it changes the features used by the random forest. And then, of course, if the attacker can change, and this is why it's it may be harder, the attacker can arbitrarily create a PDF file, right? It can add dummy content in it. It can add few pieces where it may look legitimate. So what they've what they look into is that they have like original PDFs. Let's say there is this injected content, and it turns out that PDF they also use some facts about PDF inside knowledge. For example, PDF readers jump from trailer to direct to cross-reference table, skipping injected content completely. In other words, it won't look like, it won't be a corrupted thing, so you can make it a real PDF kind of document. So why this is important, this is kind of showing that if you don't consider attacker adaptation, attackers may come up with all these features and things. And they look into two types of attack. One is called mimicry attack. So they try to transform a malicious sample so that it mimics a chosen benign sample as much as possible. So basically, you know, a good PDF file. Here the assumption is that, which I skipped, attacker knows which features of a PDF is used to detect. And of course, this is not surprising. I think there was a paper yesterday, right? So you can read the attacker can read the paper, know which features are used in that paper, and which features are used in the machine model. So attacker know that. There were some other attacks based on certain techniques. So if you know a technique like SVM, maybe you can choose more specific attacks in modifying things. And this is more applicable for SVM and so on. So they have another set of attack for against these specific things. So I will just jump to the results. These results look into different scenarios. One scenario is that it knows the feature set. In other words, attacker knows which features are used for the data mining. And then they have a few other scenarios where attacker may know feature set and the classifier used and try to use the classifier features for attacking. And then they have a combination of features training set, and so on. And then this is the score that the random forest or the classifier is giving. Before the attack happens, all the scenarios and the files that try has close to 100% score, which means that it says malware score is 100. So it's the highest score level. So before the attack happens, the classifier, before the files modified, classifier can classify with almost close to 100%. Okay. Now what will happen is that if you set the threshold as 50%, in other words, if something is higher than 50, you say that file is a malware or potential malware. What they show is that except for this scenario for mimicry with F, remember GDKD is for against specific SVM type models. What they are saying is that if the threshold is 50%, if you go below 50%, then you will be classifying many legitimate PDFs as malware. In that scenario, 75% of attacks would be classified as benign. So by changing the PDF, which was initially thought to be classified 100% accurately by this machine learning-based technique, they managed to make 75% of the attack points to be classified as benign, even with a conservative threshold of 50%. Okay, so this is an example of how a classifier built on easy to modify features. Okay, in this scenario, why it's easy to modify? If you look at the papers, this PDF thing looks like, you know, the whether it exists certain section or whether the length of the certain pattern, for example. So it has features about PDF document where in this scenario attacker can really successfully manipulate. Of course, there's a limit in the attacker scenario because still attacker needs to inject this malicious code in it somewhere. So that's the reason it cannot arbitrarily change everything, but it can change most of the things. And when it can do it, has a good success ratio. So this is not surprising because all this theoretical stuff, at least we were discussing before, was saying that if most of the features are easier to change, then attacker becomes more successful in evading the classifier. So this is, I think, one of the early work that kind of empirically showed that intuition. There are, of course, some other work as well, but I find it interesting to show this trade-off. Of course, what can you do? Again, in this work, they suggest, you know, well, why don't we do, they call it vaccination defense, modify a fraction of malicious sample in the training data set in such a way that they are more similar to expected attack samples. So their solution, in a sense, remember the previous part, the solutions we were looking into, try to model the attacker capabilities in the learning phase, right? So they are saying that maybe if you don't want to use sophisticated model like that, just add few instances modified based on the expected attack and build your models based on that, okay? Of course, this is only effective against correct anticipated attacks. So I think from practical, at least I promised some practical intuitions, I would say, this shows that anything is modifiable is quite easily deceived. Of course, if you think about PDF malware, if a malware tries to download some document, for example, if you can model that, it's very hard for attacker to change that behavior. And it's very hard to sidestep that. That was an attack for, PDF malware detection and an attack for that. And then there was some work, remember initially we talked about foundation part on learning with noise. There was some work on trying to poison the learning scenario and see the impact of it. They are doing it for crowdsourcing example. It was, I think, for using security a couple of years ago, this one. The previous one was, I think, also using security. Anyway, the citations are there. So basically what this work doing is that they look at this Sina Weibo, I think I'm not sure whether I pronounced correctly. And then look at this microblogging network. And from this network, they extracted profiles. These crowd surfing ones are you can think of them as the malicious class or the bad class. And they have authenticated users. These are known to be good classes. So this is known to be bad. This is known to be good. And then these are active users. They don't know whether exactly they are good or not, but they are more likely to be good because they have at least 50 followers and some certain number of tweets. My understanding is that in Weibo, you have something like Twitter and you tweet. So they try to use this data set to classify classify accounts, and they use again the standard machine learning techniques like SVM, Bayesian learning, like naive Bayes, usually decision tree. Decision tree is basically also very important, but random forces is an ensemble of decision trees, and usually random forces are more stable. The decision trees itself has sometimes high variance, but they use that too. So this is the data set they used in this work. So this data set had these number of accounts, and these are the tweet numbers, and there are comments. And then in this work, they extract features about like the tweet contents, how long the account was there. So there is a lot of features extracted based on the knowledge of the problem. Again, I skip those details. Again, from this discussion is not as important. So here is the how it looks like, the results. So the data set they tried to learn was they have this 28K bad accounts and 28K randomly sampled authenticated users. And now they use that. So authenticated plus turfing means that they have an equal mixture of bad and known good together to build stuff to predict the accounts. And then they have something called active and turfing. So randomly sampled active users. Again, some of the active users may be malicious, but not all of them. They are more likely to be active, and these are known turfing accounts. So here is their false positive, false negative. RF is random force. J48 is a basic decision tree classifier. It's been implemented in many things like many machine learning libraries. SVM has different for those who use SVM. It has different kernel bases. You can use radial function as a kernel, or you can use a polynomial kernel. So these SVMs are basically SVMs with different settings. For those who doesn't know, it's not as important. And then there is this Bayesian belief network, which is an extended form of Bayesian learning, if you think. Naive Bayes, as I mentioned, is usually very naive, and it doesn't work very well. So as you see, when you have authenticated good accounts combined with bad accounts, turfing accounts, you have classification as false positive, false negative quite low. Again, this is a very balanced sample. Naive Bayes doesn't work well, as I mentioned. Don't avoid the naive Bayes things. It doesn't work very well usually. And if you do active plus turfing, you would see slightly more errors here. Why? Because some of the actives may not be really good ones. So it may be deceiving the classifier, or classifier may be learning something wrong. So this is the initial setting. So it looks good. Machine learning looks like working. In this work, they show that now how we could attack this. And they look into attacking this scenario. So basically, they look into this optimal evasion attacks. So basically, what they are trying to do is that based on the features they are using, they try to do evasions. So this is more like the test time type of attack. So what happens is that it has per vertical optimal evasion. So for each instance of a bad class that tries to find the optimal features to modify to evade the classifier. And then global evasion means that you search for the best features globally, and you apply this to all bad accounts. And then the feature aware one is alter the known most important features. Like you assume some features are known to the attacker, and then the attacker chooses those. So if you look at these evasion attacks, for example, for different classifiers, here the number of features changed. Of course, as more features are changed, the more manipulation happens, and the more things becoming misclassified. In other words, after in some scenarios such as decision tree, after changing a couple of features, almost 90% or so can evade the detection. Okay. But of course, more powerful, I would say, techniques such as random forest requires more manipulation. So I think from here, it shows that, of course, understanding attacker and capabilities is important, but there's a difference between models to models. So more powerful models like random forest, this reason I always say that to start with random forest as a baseline, looks like, hopefully I won't fall down, looks like giving you a better resistance. And here, this is a global optimal, so the number of, this is effective even with few features. Why? Because this is per user, you are choosing the best thing. So here it's a global, so you may need a little bit more to reach the 100% rate, but eventually it's still going there. If you look at decision tree and random forest, they are slightly, still the random forest requires slightly more, but eventually they catch each other. And of course, here it's somewhere in between the SVMs. And also you see similar results here, but here you have a slightly different result, but at the end, all of them really comes and the evasion is successful. Again, why this is possible? Because attacker can easily modify the features that you are using. And these empirical results, again, showing that if this is the case, machine learning technique could be attacked easily. Of course, the previous ones require lots of knowledge about the classifier, what are the best features globally, locally, etc. So basically, in this work, they look into more practical ones. In other words, their argument for more practical is, which I would agree as well, is requires less information on the side of the attacker. So for example, in the random evasion attack, some of the features randomly chosen and changed. Of course, as you see, when you do random features changed, it's not as successful. It requires more and more features actually to even get to 100% rate. So of course, this kind of shows, not surprisingly, more information attacker has, easier for attacker to adapt the classifier. So this is a empirically interesting point, basically, that usually in security, when we talk about, you know, like security of a system, you want to disclose everything about the system as much as possible. You don't want to do security by obscurity. But here, of course, obscuring a little bit helps in that because the attacker may not know the classifier as well, so it's harder for it to adapt to the classifier. The value distance aware strategy and distribution distance aware strategy is assuming that attacker knows something about good class and their value distributions, so it can choose features that are trying to mimic the good class. The difference is not as important, but not surprisingly, if the attacker has more information, it requires less number of features to change. So the more information attacker has, easier to evade. The less information attacker has, it's harder to evade, basically. So this is an important, I think, distinction from this work. Now, remember, I was also promising you that what happens to poisoning attack. So they look at the poisoning attack training data set by injecting random normal users samples to the turfing class. So here, ratio of poison to turfing. So you have basically, and you have the false positive rate. So of course, if you add more, so this is the ratio, almost 50% poison, 50% turfing, you would see that especially for some classifiers like random forest, the false positive rates move from something to here. So coming back to early theoretical thing, if you still remember in the very first part of the tutorial, well, we were saying that as long as the beta, in other words, what the malicious attacker can modify is small enough, still we can learn a good classifier. Here, if you look at the ratios, maybe this is, remember this is like a little log scale 0.01 to all the way to 1. Even if, I don't know what this number here is, that there is a slight increase, even though almost 50%-ish or bad data added. So of course this depends on the, remember the theoretical result, it depends on the concept, it depends on the learning algorithm, but this empirical kind of validates that. In other words, as long as the poison instances are not too big, and if you have a large enough data, the loss in accuracy due to this poisoning doesn't look like too much for a strong basically classification techniques. Of course, for others like SVM radial function, slightly worse. And if you look at the decision tree, which I, as I mentioned, they are known to be not very stable. That's the reason most people use random forest instead of having just one decision tree, is doing much worse due to poisoning attack, and especially you can see the jump. They look at poisoning between, like, the professional workers means, like, they add poison to authenticated users, and then they had all workers, and you see similar rich results here as well. Of course, they do each experiment n times. I think it was 10 times. Just like, so that's the error bars here. Yes, Sting? Which one in this work?
The previous one, the worker thing. Yeah,
this work, in this one, each worker, based on the profile, they extracted certain features. Okay, they had many features. Now, attacker, let's say I have a fake profile. I'm a turfer or whatever. Yeah. Yeah.
Do they any of those can study, for example, they may change all the feature, they can evade detection 100%, but then they cannot do anything bad anymore. So
that's the utility. I don't think they look at the utility in this scenario. Okay. They try to limit the utility more like on the number of features. Actually, I was in that talk. I was in the talk of this paper a long time ago. I don't think they discussed that. Yeah. If I'm not mistaken. Correct. That's the reason, I mean, I was talking about at least the other more machine learning data mining work, talking about utility of the attacker, like cost of changing and so on. Right? So you need to really look into the cost. So in this scenario, I think they are kind of saying that, for example, attacker can change 5 features without impacting the bad things that they can do. I mean, implicitly, that's the assumption. I don't think they evaluate it because I don't think they go back to turfers to do anything bad or something like that. They just assume that's the case. They also look into inject specific type of normal users to turfing class. So in other words, they look into what happens if you add some good data points to the bad class. Kind of coming to what you say, so, right, you were inverse. So here they try to inject normal users to turfing class and see how the classifier accuracy is changing there. Again, results are, so they are injecting accounts with 50% tweets commented. So this tweets commented is an important feature that they use. So the assumption is that if you have tweets and many people comment your tweets, then it's a good indication of that your account is legitimate. Again, after you add lots of good class, if you think about conceptually, is that good class and injected bad class after you inject many, many good accounts look very similar in this point. So therefore, false positive rate jumps up. But again, it can withstand to some amount, like, I don't know whether this is like where this points here. Similarly, they look at different type of accounts, injecting accounts with less than 150 followers. So they inject certain type of bad accounts. Again, the techniques look like resistance to a point, then it jumps up. So as I mentioned, with the theory goes, there's a limit that you can handle if you have large enough data to poisoning attacks. So there are a few additional ones. They also look at the impact of poisoning on, instead of adding any data to the training set, they look into modifying the data in the training set. So for random, so for different classifiers, they look at modifying different type of data based on some kind of features like entropy measures, burstiness, I don't recall what burstiness is, like based on some profile information, changing profile information. These are the feature categories actually they use, and then they change those categories to reflect the other class. And of course, basically changing different features may have different impact on the features that's in terms of classification accuracy. But if you think about features that are none means nothing attacked in this scenario, it looks like here just modifying one feature in one class look like doesn't impact the results as much. So if you see, they are somewhat similar, although there are some increases here and there. Overall, they look similar. So, what all this means, at least from attacker point of view, and coming back to the foundational results, is that I think there is a strong indication that you need to really look into behavioral features. So the features that are easy to modify, such as the PDF files, you know, strings in it, or online profile or tweet numbers, etc., is quite easy to detect or quite easy to manipulate. So I chose some examples. Again, there are zillions of papers doing malware, mobile malware detection, but I think behavioral features, especially if the attacker wants to achieve a certain goal, would be harder to prevent. So for example, there was the paper yesterday, right? I don't know whether you attended that one, talking about extracting features from papers, and some of the features shown was like sending SMS, whether the malware or the software is calling an API function that allows the software to send SMS. It turns out that this is a very good predictor for a certain type of malware, and and it's also hard for attacker to change it, right? If your malware's main point is to send SMS to a certain page sites, whatever, you may change the software source code, this and that, but it will be very hard to change this SMS sending part, because that's the main behavior of the malware. So that's, for that reason, I think looking into behavioral aspects of malicious thing done by the attacker, whether it's a spam. Because in the spam, for example, they ask you to click something or go to do some action. Or in terms of malware, where they try to, for example, exfiltrate data, or well, they try to send SMS, looks like a looks like a better way to do it. I chose one example on this, and then there was some discussion yesterday on using data mining for that. But again, I think the important part is from adversarial aspect is at least. From outside, it looks like it will be much harder to for attacker to manipulate the behavior, as the previous discussion says that because it wants to achieve this malicious goal it has. Maybe all other things may not be as important, like you know which other API calls it's doing, but it has to do certain API calls to do that. So this example, this paper looks into machine learning behavior, but they look at the runtime behavior of an application. So this is important again because you can change lots of things in the binary, right? But during runtime, again, the attacker has certain goals, say, let's say sending SMS or exfiltrating data. That will be much, much harder to change. So this is, you can think of it as building a machine learning model based on features that are harder to change by the attacker. Okay, so this work is an example. As I mentioned, there are like zillions of work. I just chose one. And then this is, of course, will be more resilient to worms or code obfuscation or other techniques. Why? Because they are very easy to modify, but not the behavior. Of course, how do you learn the behavior? What they do is that they trying to, again, learn an SVM model. And they try to differentiate partial signature for malicious behavior from normal applications. And in order to do that, they really look into call graph and behavioral things. So what basically they are doing is that they try to, by observing lots of runtime behavior of apps, they have normal application patterns and malware. And then they build an SVM, and then this SVM is deployed on the smartphone, and it will be basically observing the runtime behavior of the application, and based on that, it tries to classify. So what they are doing is that they try to look into the behavior of a certain type of malware, such as the API calls it does, and then it tries to create this behavior signature of the API calls or the runtime behavior based on the calls. And then, of course, it will be harder to build a machine learning model directly on this big function called trees, and it may not be as accurate. So instead, they try to aggregate that and try to create some kind of more simplified runtime behavior signature here. And then they, of course, how do they do it? They do like graph pruning and aggregation to come up with this more compact representation of the runtime signatures. And this way they could basically build models. So I chose this, as I mentioned, as an example of building classifier on harder to evade features, such as the runtime behavior. Of course, now when you go into big data models, and then you need to, yeah, go ahead. So the assumption is that there is certain malware behavior that the malware must be doing to achieve success. So like if the malware is about stealing sensitive information, then it should access that sensitive information. Eventually it should send that sensitive information. So if you have a runtime behavior monitoring system that looks at, like, you know, doing some taint analysis to figure out where this, whether the sensitive information went to this app and whether it's sent to the internet, that will be very hard to change whatever it does in the middle. Makes, I mean, at least that's my my intuition. Definitely, there will be false positive, false negatives. But my only argument is that this will be much harder to evade than a technique that looks at non-behavioral things. Because, like, if you look at initial like the binary, for example, that will be much, much harder to do because it can be obfuscated and so on. But in the behavioral scenario, again, it may look like a legitimate app's behavior, but I would be also suspicious if a legitimate app is sending too much sensitive information, for example, to the cloud. So again, of course, there will be some false positives probably, but this will be harder to evade. That's my only argument, because that behavior, by at least by definition, the adversary tries to achieve. Make sense? Yeah. So basically, this kind of argues that, you know, I mean, I kind of argue that dynamic analysis is harder to evade, obviously. Well, it's more expensive, probably, than static analysis. It's much easier to evade because the features in static analysis is very easy to evade in machine learning models. Right. So, I mean, I try to tie this to the hard, like, the, if you recall the first part, you were saying that choose features that are predictive and harder to manipulate, right? So behavioral features look like those type of features because they are harder to manipulate because the malware needs to achieve the intended behavior. And also they are predictive, hopefully more predictive. But that was the... Yeah, exactly, exactly. Of course, I mean, that's the entire thing. You need to have some set of features that's distinguishing legitimate from the bad class. Otherwise, there is no hope, obviously, because if all the features you look at, if they are similar, right, then you cannot differentiate them. Clearly, that must be the case. You need to have such features. No, I mean, what I meant by such a feature is it may not be as simple. So because what if you have if-then type of features, it means that classification boundary is simple enough. What I mean is that you have, if you think about the high dimensional space, the overlap bit based when you project the instances based on the features that you are using, there shouldn't be significant overlap between two classes. So remember this examples I keep showing. Okay. So remember these examples, right? So this is just two features, and as you see, this two classes well separated. So you need to have set of features on the high dimensional space that doesn't cause too much overlap. It doesn't mean that it's a simple if and then. So if you think about SVMs, they do these kernel tricks to really go into very high dimensional space with the kernel trick so that you can get a separation. So it's not as simple as if then.
Yeah, but for instance, decision trees are
Basically, if it's a decision tree, so you have if here and if then, etc. When you have random forests, but it really divides the entire space, especially when you randomize also on the set of features. When you do random forests, it divides the space into different regions where you have different labels. So it's slightly more complex than simple if then. And of course, how to learn that if then statements is the challenge, and you try to automate that as well.
Yeah, I agree.
So I think I'm not understanding the question.
It was just a comment that it's a trade-off between problems that are basically characterizable by a smaller set of features, and those are not handled by machine learning. And here we are talking about problems which are not so obvious.
Yeah. Otherwise, you would have 100% accuracy, and that would be very challenging to have 100% accuracy. Then that would be deterministic classification. Clearly, there will be errors, and clearly there will be some apps who are very legitimate apps, but they may behave like malware in terms of, you know, sending lots of sensitive information. So those apps will be classified as malware, even though they may not be malware, and that was, I think, the previous point. So clearly, reaching 100% accuracy is not feasible, I think, for most scenarios, almost all scenarios. I don't think it's feasible. So clearly, you will have false positive, false negatives. That's the reason I will talk about some criticism of machine learning in general. I think there is a very nice paper, if you haven't read, I will talk about it. So there is, of course, there's also additional things needs to be done. I just throw in another thing, like when you have, go ahead.
What's the time frame for feature extraction and classification in some of these, like just broadly?
Time frame, you mean like how long it takes to do those steps?
Yeah.
So most of the, if you look at the literature, non-cyber security literature on how long does it take to do, you know, data cleaning, data transformation, feature extraction, they say it takes the 80 to 90% of your total project time, and the 10% is doing the data mining, machine learning. So usually, you know, cleaning the data, extracting the features, etc., is the most time-consuming step. Is that what you're asking? Oh, it depends on what type of feature extraction techniques. Most of the examples, like it's 1 second or something, it's very quick.
Wow, because I've seen some work that suggests that the techniques that are being used currently are too slow for things like app stores to be able to use effectively because they get so many submissions on a regular basis.
I think it depends on the techniques. So some for more dynamic analysis techniques needs to, I think, run for a longer time because you want to understand the behavior, right? And during the behavior, on the App Store, they may be, they run this app in a virtual machine type of environment, and then they need to observe it for a certain amount of time. So it may, and then you have hundreds of thousands of apps, then it may be time consuming. But of course, you can distribute it and do those kind of tricks. So it depends on, again, that's the reason, like the feature extraction has a cost as well in scenarios. One thing was on how to learn these kind of behavioral models in the big data setting. There was some work people looking to distributing the data mining of this into the mobile cloud or mobile devices themselves instead of sending each data extracted from a different mobile device to the cloud and build the data mining model. Some people look into how to do this in a distributed fashion. And in order to deal with big data, usually distributed classification is the way to go. In this work, they did divide this quadratic SVM binary classification into smaller problems so that it could be solved by distributed scenario. And They look at using this distributed technique for accuracy, and here contaminated samples means there is a malware, normal samples means the normal scenario. Here you learn again behavioral SVMs and so on. but you do it in a distributed manner, so you don't need to send everything back to the cloud for doing learning and tasks and so on. So they are kind of showing that this is requires less interaction, less iteration for the mobile devices. Again, I just wanted to give one example here. There are many, many papers who look into distributed learning scenarios. Before I finish, I want to look into, I think, an excellent paper, I think 6 years ago or so, on criticism of machine learning. And I want to tie back with some of the theoretical things we discussed. And the title of this work was the Outside the Closed World on Using Machine Learning for Network Intrusion Detection. This paper really tried to differentiate between misuse detection, like precise descriptions of non-malicious behavior versus anomaly detection. In other words, deviation from normal activities. And then it really looked into several problems, such as high false positive rate. This is still a problem because there is no 100% accurate machine learning technique, and usually an analyst needs to look at the final result. So how does it impact the analyst's time and so on? And then they also say that lack of attack-free data for training is an issue. But as the theoretical results indicate, if you have big enough data and if the contamination is not too large, like the previous examples show, I think this shouldn't be a problem. But again, this paper mentions it as an important problem. And then they say that, oh, look, attackers can fault the system, evade the detection. Again, the entire first part of the talk was about how to have more resistant techniques to do that. And finally, should they mention about difficulties with evaluation? One thing which I didn't discuss today, and I think it's a very important issue, is the semantic gap and interpretation of the results, basically. And that's, I guess, biggest criticism which hasn't been addressed as well. In other words, when you throw in a complex machine learning model such as SVM over thousands of features, and it comes up with a model and says this is benign or this is not benign, what does it mean? Okay, why it says so? And that's really hard to interpret. There are some work in machine learning things, especially like decision tree or random forest, where you could get more human understandable outputs, but still there is a semantic gap is there. And of course, the error costs is sometimes could be high in the networking setting, like when you do false positives, false negatives. But I think this is kind of being addressed nowadays with the classifiers that get these costs into it. Outlier detection is, which we didn't touch as much, but outlier detection, of course, happens because some normal behavior look like an outlier due to changes and so on. Still, you need to have some kind of human in the loop. So that's where the human come into play. So this is basically an active area in a sense. You need to add all those aspects. So what this paper's recommendation was, understanding the threat model is important, and still I think this is also all the theoretical models look into, like what kind of environment does the system target, what do the missed attacks cost, what the attackers' skills and resources, and what concern does evasion pose. So this is, I think, their recommendation, and the theoretical models have similar recommendations. In a sense, if you remember, all of these models try to really actively try to answer these questions and model these questions to come up with more resistance model. I think keeping the scope narrow, again, these are their suggestions. So you usually building a classifier to predict some subtask is easier than, let's say, more generic task. What I mean by is, let's say you want to build a classifier on Twitter to figure out all public unrests, okay? It's usually much harder to, for example, build a classifier just predicting protests or just predicting, let's say, riots or something. So it's usually easier to do classifiers predicting some certain subclass instead of a generic class. So there, the scope narrow is that maybe you can have multiple classifiers instead of just one big one. So that's the idea. Of course, reducing the cost means that, you know, there is the cost involved from the evasion attacker points, and you need to consider those. Of course, evaluation is, I think, the semantic gap of understanding results are still there. Oops. So I think I'll finish a little bit early. Sorry. So to conclude, I know there are many results we discussed. This is, by the way, their conclusion. I will come to our conclusions in a second. They are saying that there is this domain-specific challenge of applying machine learning-based detection techniques and deploy them. But as I mentioned at the very beginning, now there are startups who are trying to change that. So there are now many startups who are trying to do machine learning-based detection systems and try to deploy them. So it's, I think, changing. And then obtaining, of course, insights from the domain experts and bringing semantic understanding into the machine learning domain, I think, is an active area. In other words, like combining machine learning automated data analysis techniques with human intuition is the recent active research. The machine learning community has done active learning work in the past. They call it active learning. But I think this is an important aspect as well. Again, this is from the citation number 9. So this is my conclusion. Sorry, there's a confusion. To summarize what I'll try to convey, I guess, with all the equations, applying data mining for cybersecurity really requires better understanding of attackers. So it's not surprising for, I think, cybersecurity people. But just applying machine learning data mining techniques itself doesn't solve. As you see, the foundational results, like game theory, provide some natural tools for modeling. But it's just to get some intuitions, maybe. And you really need to figure out at least the adversaries' capabilities, their adaptation, their cost of adaptation, and the utility for the attacker and defender for certain options. At least all the theoretical models indicate that that needs to be considered to have an effective long-term solution. I haven't discussed many things. One example is provenance of data, like where the data is coming from, who touched it, may have important implications for building the mining models. And against poisoning attacks, for example, which is itself is important. And there are many other issues that I didn't touch, but I try to at least highlight the differences of machine learning data mining for cybersecurity. So I guess this is all this theoretical stuff is not so far away from ancient wisdom. I think this is a couple of thousand years old, right? So you need to, you need to know the enemy and yourself. So here, in order to really apply machine learning for data mining or big data for cybersecurity, you need to know the enemy and you need to know the potential adaptations. Otherwise, it will not be very useful. This means that choose the features very carefully. So the rights of features, I think, are more important than the data mining models that you are using. But of course, as we have seen in some examples, robust machine learning techniques are better. And final thing is the big data. Remember, in the title, I had the big or sexy part. So what does the big data involve? Of course, you need to scale to large data because the data is getting larger. I think choosing right of features, right features for classification says good features are really hard for attacker to manipulate, and they are indicative of attack. So in other words, a feature that is hard to manipulate and differentiates good versus bad in terms of like information threatening sense, etc., that's a good feature. And if you build good features, if you build classifiers, machine learning models based on such good features, at least the theory suggests they are more likely to withstand the evasion attacks and so on. So we were talking about malware detection. So in the malware detection, this says that, you know, synthetic features extracted from binary should be quickly useless. An attacker could quickly adapt to that because the change cost is very little. But behavioral features is probably harder to modify because it requires changing the behavior of the malware, which is substantially harder. Of course, now, like, what's the right machine learning tool? I didn't touch on this area. There is so hot topic like deep belief networks. You know, it's now, if you have a startup on anything deep belief network, it's highly valued. So it's now the hype thing. There are, of course, many techniques, tools we used. So I think using different tools and so on could be critical. But of course, more resistant tools such as, you know, random forest, or we have some candidates such as SVM, could be a better idea. But of course, there may be others. So I don't think there is one right machine learning technique for one detection. So you need to really try them for your task and see, of course, after starting with the good features. In other words, the features that are hard for attacker to manipulate and indicative of attack, basically. In the previous examples, we talk about like sending SMS. Maybe it's only few of the legitimate apps send SMS. Let's say if that's the case, that's a good feature for against an SMS malware. I didn't talk too much on this part of efficient distributed processing. You could give an entire 2 days tutorial on any one of them. And actually, if you Google online, you would find, you know, topics on these big data management systems. So current intuition is that if in order to scale to big data, you really need to have some kind of distributed processing system built on top of, standard commercial hardware. The early example was Hadoop MapReduce, popularized by Google. And then there is now Spark, I would say, becoming at least my favorite tool used on top of Hadoop. And there are a few others on, they call it NoSQL database systems. And I will just mention Spark briefly. Because Spark is basically a fast general purpose cluster computing system. So you can have 100 machines and you can go for terabytes of data. And the nice thing about these kind of tools is that it has APIs in many, many languages such as Java, Scala, Python. And then they have an optimized engine that supports general execution graphs. I'm not going too much into the Spark, that was my initial thing, but I realized that it will require maybe like 1 hour itself to even give basic ideas of how Spark works and the libraries and so on. But here from our purpose is that if you have a 1 terabyte of data and you want to build machine learning models for that, you can't do it on one machine, you need to distribute. But of course, instead of running your own distributed code to learn these models, there is already things like Apache Spark and Hadoop and so on that you can use the things. Spark is especially interesting because it has machine learning libraries already on it, and this SVM, random forest, naive Bayes, and there are some also clustering techniques that are automatically built there. And they are built in a way that it could, the model learning itself could be distributed. So therefore, once you figure out good features and nice techniques and so on, you need to distribute it for the big data. And these kind of Spark type of things can do it automatically for you without need to worry about the like scaling by yourself. And as I mentioned, it has lots of libraries. I won't be talking about those libraries as much, but as I mentioned, they implement most common machine learning tools, such as random forests and so on. And they have support for like Java, Scala, Python, so you can write easily code on that. And there are other things like Spark Streaming, which is interesting if you want to update your models on the fly. So you can have a streaming framework where you can, the data is keep coming and you change your updating model. So that's also possible. So I'll stop here. That was my acknowledgement. I will stop 20 minutes earlier. I guess not, you didn't ask too many questions. I will share the slides online, and I will put a few more pointers to Spark for those anyone. I know most people know it, but it's there. So, and I would be happy to answer more questions. So that's what I have. Thanks. I will put the slides online, and I think they will link from the website, but you can send me an email if you can't find the link from my website. Thanks for coming.